it because it's not my night. So, I will say welcome to CSU Monterey Bay. This is CSU Monterey Bay, and this is CSU Monterey Bay, whether some people like it or not. My name is Vito. I've been the chairman for the events work group for the last 3 years, and I'd like to say that it's an honor for the events work group and for myself to be collaborating with Semana de la Raza for the third year in a row. I'm going to invite Estella to the stage in just a moment. She can tell you more about that. Tonight's event is on the topic of perpetual war, U.S. state-sponsored terrorism, and the limits of academic dissent. There will be a question and answer period after the lecture. There's a microphone over here in the corner, and also in this corner. We're gonna have people line up and we'll alternate left and right, left and right, left and right. And when you're formulating your questions, I'd like you to please try to formulate them along the lines of tonight's topic. Well, you know. This is, as I mentioned before, this is an event sponsored by the events work group of CSU Monterey Bay and the CSU Monterey Bay Mecha. So please turn off your cell phones. Cell phones, make sure they're off, and there will be no flash photography this evening, if you don't mind. And if everyone's settled, then I'd like to invite Estella to the stage from Mecha.
Welcome, everybody. My name is Estela Hernandez. I am currently one of the co-chairs for CSUMB's Mecha. El Movimiento Estudiantil Chicano de Aztlán, also known as Mecha, is a 36-year-old national organization. Here at CSUMB, Mecha has been an active organization since 1996. Amongst our missions, we dedicate special effort to promoting Chicano-Chicano culture, multiculturalism, and consciousness raising through higher education. Semana de la Raza is a week-long series of events typically held on the first week of May. Semana de la Raza highlights and celebrates Chicano-Chicana culture and promotes social and political awareness. These events vary from guest lectures, art exhibits, and festivals. Almost all events are free, and all events are open to the CSUMB community and the surrounding communities. This year, our Año Semana de la Raza theme, Revolutionizing the Globe, Educación, Cultura y Paz. Amongst our events include a film showing of Discovering Dominga and live entertainment. We also have a Lunada on Wednesday with live band, Floricanto, piñatas, games, and more. On Cinco de Mayo, we have a celebration in the main campus quad, and we also have an evening of Cultura, Arte, y Música at night. On Friday, we have a founding faculty recognition and the showing of American Me. On Saturday, May 7th, we have Pachanga 10 here in the UC Ballroom and open to the public. For today, we have invited as our keynote speaker, Professor Ward Churchill. Ward Churchill. Ward Churchill, a Kitowa, band Cherokee, is a professor of American Indian Studies and former chair of the Ethnic Studies Department at the University of Colorado at Boulder, where he has worked since 1978. He is also on the Leadership Council for the American Indian Movement of Colorado. He has authored, co-authored, and edited more than 20 books, including A Little Matter of Genocide, Holocaust and Denial in the Americans, 1492 to the present, Acts of Rebellion, The Ward Churchill Reader, and Agents of Repression, the FBI's Secret Wars Against the Black Panther Party and the American Indian Movement. He has received numerous writing and teaching awards. As of 2001, was the most cited scholar in his field. In 2004, Professor Churchill was named runner-up for the Gustavus Myers Award and Best Writing on Human Rights for On the Justice of Roosting Chickens, Reflection on the Consequences of U.S. Imperial Arrogance and Criminality, and was inducted into the Martin Luther King Collection of Scholars. Please join me in welcoming Professor Ward Churchill.
Osio, Osiju. Hello, my relatives. Good to see you here. I bring you greetings from the Kituwa Band of Cherokee, my people, from Colorado chapter of the American Indian Movement, of which I'm a part, and from Gwarthy Las, otherwise known as Leonard Peltier, who tonight, as I speak to you, continues to sit in a cage to federal prison at Leavenworth, Kansas. Not for anything anyone, including even his prosecutor, at any point in the past 20 years has been prepared to say they believe he actually did, but rather as a symbol of the arbitrary ability of the federal government of the United States to repress the legitimate aspirations to liberation of indigenous people within its claimed boundaries. And note the emphasis there is on claim. There's a difference between a claim and a reality. And that difference is something we'll be talking about a bit tonight. And that difference accounts for what it is that Leonard was struggling against to put him in that cage. Put him in a cage to send a message. And that message is, if you stand on your rights, if you actually struggle for, exercise your rights, there's costs and consequences. And I got about 4,000 emails over the last, 90 days reaffirming that point. Of course, I believe in free speech, but with free speech come consequences. Well, hot news flash, all you constitutional scholars out there. If there's consequences, those are costs. And if there's costs, it ain't free. I got a little list of things they asked me to address tonight, beginning with my case. Well, I'll speak to that. I'm probably unique in the country at this very moment. I'm probably not going to stay that way, but at this moment, I'm probably the only academic that two state governors, three legislatures, one board of regents, and those weasels that form the administration of my own institution have called upon to be fired. I've actually got legislative votes to that effect. I'm actually a laboratory case for a new set of techniques that arise out of but are not synonymous with the old McCarthyite impulse, the notion of a purge. And I'm going to begin there, and I'll probably end the talk with this as well, but in somewhat different ground. Over one 60-day period in Colorado, centering on Denver, which is not exactly my hometown, but that's the major metropolitan area. In that 60-day period, I had 200 hits, including 11 front-page stories in the Denver Post, and over 200 in the Rocky Mountain News, and very nearly 200 in the Boulder Daily Camera, and another probably 60 in the Colorado Daily. And as capitalist Silverman, Peter Boyle, and Gunny Bob put it on Clear Channel, all Churchill, all the time. I know I have the distinction of being the only academic in the country that has my own dedicated program on Fox News during that period. And I want to thank Bill O'Reilly sincerely for sacrificing his program and retitling it the Ward Churchill Factor for 31 straight days. Actually, you could say Bill is why I'm here. And he hasn't yet asked for a kickback. Of course, he charges a little more than I do and probably therefore doesn't need it. But that's the laboratory case. Can you, with sheer media concentration coupled to the posturing of political power for a particular set of purposes, which include diversions in the case of the Colorado governor, Mr. Family Values, who needed to take the heat off his wife leaving him because she caught him in flagrant delicto with a staff member who was serving as his mistress at the time. I guess that's why she was paid. There was something in there about mis-expenditure of taxpayers' dollars, but he didn't want to talk about it in that connection. And the, well, what was it Boyle called them? Smoking babies, the two illegitimate children he's reputed to have fathered since he's been in the governor's office, bearing the standard of the Christian right. Obviously, he needed something to take attention off himself, and this pretty well did the trick. So you can see what his vestiture of interest might have been, aside from a straight, what do they call that, Republican agenda? Well, if you could take that kind of concentration and accomplish what they used to call in the FBI neutralization of targets simply in and of itself, the media blitz coupled to political posturing would accomplish the desired result and you wouldn't need to go any further. Well, I'm pleased to announce that it failed. I'm still standing. Department's still standing, and they flat run out of steam. All of a sudden, well, what do you think about this runaway bride? Yeah. Michael Jackson's what? I mean, Michael Jackson ended up subsidizing my entire defense campaign for the pleasure of having me take him off the front page for a protracted period of time. Yeah, it didn't work. That's the upside of things. Downside is, these are not unintelligent beings. I'm not sure whether I want really to dignify them with the term people, but the beings that orchestrated this do learn from their mistakes, and they overplayed their hand. This was too much concentration too fast. Even O'Reilly's faithful, these weren't critics. This was his own regular viewers were writing emails by the end of the third week of this saying, hey, lighten up. There's other things happening in the world here. And they kept making mistakes because they had not done their homework before the fact, shooting from the hip. This will not be repeated in the same form. They will use the same technique, but they will have learned from these lessons and target other people, and they will probably target other people more effectively than they have targeted me. Having failed on lynching for speech, they've now slid over to something that sounds much more weighty and dignified. We've determined that he actually had a right to say. Well, there was a question about that in the first place. We couldn't find the line that he crossed. That's because there are none. There's no lines on speech beyond which you're not allowed to go other than into the area of criminal sanction, and the investigative body would not be an ad hoc committee. In some university, it would be the Federal Bureau of Investigation. And I'm reasonably familiar with those guys. And if they had a sedition case or a treason case or a material support to terrorism case or any other kind of criminal case that they could have brought on the basis of what I said, I would be duly sitting in a cell and awaiting trial. That was never part of the deal. So there are no lines to cross in terms of speech content by a faculty member or just plain straight-up citizen, for that matter, in terms of offering a political analysis of circumstances and events. There are lines beyond which governors of states, legislatures, and so forth, in intervening in the public discourse, they're not to go, and they've crossed every one of them. However, since they're writing the laws, they don't criminally sanction that sort of line crossing. They don't even lose their jobs, although, you know, on the basis of competency, which was the issue that the governor raised around me, I'd return a compliment and say on that basis he should have been fired long ago. And since he hangs his hat on moral virtue, well, you take it from there, dot, dot, dot. So now they're investigating whether to investigate allegations launched by eminent scholars that I have plagiarized myself. True story. Pull down John Lavelle's essay and see what he actually said. Distorting sources. Well, Lavelle said, I wrote the pieces that I'm accused of plagiarizing, which ain't plagiarism. To accuse me of plagiarism based on what he said is a distortion of source on a major scale, therefore I've filed or will file on Monday, I don't know whether the paperwork went in yet, academic misconduct charges on my accusers in the university. If we're going to play, we're going to play, okay? Distortion of sources, plagiarism, and misrepresenting circumstances with regard to the Fort Clark incident of 1836, whether or not the Army actually intended smallpox to break out among the Mandans, kill about 100,000 Indians, and whether there were actually 100,000 Indians to kill. These are the weighty issues. Oh yeah, I forgot. Are Ojibwe's matriarchal or not? And the Crusher. Now here's the real research interest question. Am I an Indian? Am I an Indian? There's some real interesting email in this, which I'm actually compiling, published with a little, be fairly short, because I'm just going to do selected. They get redundant after a while. Collection of emails out of the roughly 18,000 received since the end of January. There's these two real neat batches. One goes something like this. I'll give you selected highlights. Shivington should have finished the job. For those of you out there unfamiliar with American history, John Shivington was the Methodist minister turned volunteer cavalry colonel who headed up the Sand Creek Massacre under the premise that nits make lice. A nit, for those of you who are not familiar with biology, are baby lice. In other words, kill their babies. Shivington should have finished the job, he didn't kill you all. Or another one, Hitler picked the wrong people. He should have started with your great-grandparents. Work it out from there. Oh, I've got a whole pile. Real cute ones. And then on the other hand, when they're not engaging in this kind of invective, based upon my presumptive Indianness, they're saying I'm not an Indian at all. That's serious insult, you phony wannabe Indian. And these are all white guys. So what is it they're saying I am if I'm not Indian? The worst thing they can think to call me is a white guy? Good God. What kind of self-concept afflicts these reactionary beings? And there we have it. More could be said. I'll turn back to what the agenda actually is towards the end of the talk. But that's the situation as it stands. You don't back up. They don't know what to do. You're supposed to cave in, you're supposed to whimper, you're supposed to cry, you're supposed to pray for your job and ask forgiveness for speaking what you see to be the truth in a full, forceful, public fashion. That's the issue. And this big part of the agenda is to prevent people from doing exactly that. And that's the whole substance of the democratic process. And it's the whole substance of the academic process. If you are not free to say what you believe to be true and why, right, wrong, or indifferent, there is no discourse. And that's what it is that's to be quelled. That's what it is that's to be quelled. So what's all this about? Well, certainly not what they say it is, but then again, maybe so, in a certain weird way. This really comes down to a roughly 20-page stream of consciousness gut reaction piece, an op-ed in extended fashion, posted on an obscure website on the 12th of September 2001 that was discovered by some college editor in Hamilton, New York, and sent by email to Bill O'Reilly, who immediately turned it into national news. 3 years and change after the fact. Man, most university professors would be delighted to have somebody pay that much attention to a throwaway piece. Of course, I've been working on the throwaway piece, and it was in the process of being released as a book at that time. Now, the op editors in Denver made much of the fact that my op-ed didn't have footnotes. They said in unfootnoted op-ed pieces in Denver. Yeah. I pointed that out. but that didn't see print. I also pointed out that the same piece refined, polished up, because nobody writes clean text. Even Ernest Hemingway didn't manage that fact in one take at length in a given afternoon. But it had been polished, it had been refined, it had been perfected, it had been annotated 178 footnotes deep, served as a lead essay in the book that was mentioned that got the human rights runner-up notice. They don't want to talk about that. They don't want to read it either. In fact, most of the people who have been sending me the really serious emails have never read the blog piece either. Don't confuse me with facts. I want to hate you, and I want to hate you a lot. And if I read the thing, I might not be able to hate you successfully, so let me forget about the facts and just hate you, damn it. Okay. Because as the young Republicans here did or did not, because it's apparently a forgery according to them, branded me today, I'm a hate monger. Let me hate you because you're a hate monger, by God. In fact, you insulted somebody that I didn't even know, but I hold dear in a symbolic fashion, and therefore perhaps I'll even kill you. Yeah. And that's in the name of peace. And don't forget it. But what was the offending piece for those who hadn't read it? And why did it get written in the first place? Well, I don't know if you remember what you were doing on the morning of September 11, 2001, but I do. I was doing what I always do, because I get up about 6 o'clock and I go to the word processor with a pack of Pell-Mells and a cup of black coffee, and I get some work done, because that's usually before the phone will start ringing and the sirens start sirening and all the rest of the conveniences of modern life that disrupt any possibility of unfragmented thought. So I was doing that when the phone rang. Oh yeah, great. But I got one of those tricky little technological gadgets called caller ID, and I recognized the name as being a good friend from the old days of the Black Panther Party, Kathleen Cleaver. So I answered. And she said, is your TV on? I said, hell no. And she said, well, go turn it on, because somebody just flew a plane into the World Trade Center. Well, that caught my attention, because it was Kathleen, so she wouldn't be running some nonsense on me. She said it was probably true, so yeah, I turned my TV and watched the second plane come in real time. And by the time the fireball had extended the other side, and I got all three, hey, having satellite, got all three channels, major channel kinds of news coverage, and I'm flipping back and forth between them, and by the time the fireball is done, they're already describing this as senseless. That's the word, all three channels, it's being packaged that way. This senseless act, this senseless act, this senseless, 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 senseless act. And I'm sitting there saying to myself, yeah, right. I'm in a little bit of shock too. This is kind of spectacular. It doesn't matter what your position or your perspective may be. This is not something you're going to be seeing every day. And somebody has just flown two commercial airliners with great degree of precision into the World Trade Center, taking both towers, and they're telling me somebody else has flown another one into the Pentagon, and there's a fourth one out there someplace over Pennsylvania, which, oh yeah, whatever happened to that one? Story flipped over that day, but I don't want to go there because that goes into conspiracy mongering stuff. Okay? Well, whatever happened to that fourth one wasn't what they said happened. I'll just leave it at that. But three planes, three hits, obvious targets. This is not happening by accident. This isn't happen extemporaneously. Somebody has very carefully planned what it is that's happening. I don't know who it is at the moment. But they planned it. If they planned it, they had a purpose. It's not irrational in a sense that it's random. If there's a purpose, there's a motive. Motive and purpose you can agree with, you can disagree with, but you cannot in any conceivable fashion call it senseless. It has sense. The point then is to understand what that sense might be. What was the purpose? If you can understand the motive, you can get to the purpose. what would motivate someone to do what they just did, because what they did was immolate themselves along with the other people that are being killed. And they're talking at that point about 18,000-19,000 people, perhaps. Turns out to be 3,000 overall is the rough number. But senseless, that's what I'm responding to. Now the telephone's ringing again. It's the editor of Dark Knight Field Notes says, we need a gut response to this. We need your immediate take. What's happening? And we need it in time to post it on the website tomorrow. And so I sat back at the word processor, changed to a blank screen, and wrote the offending piece. Well, my first response, I've talked to a lot of other people that have had that same response that morning while they were watching it. The thing that occurred to me immediately was in the night of John Kennedy's assassination, a bunch of reporters got to Malcolm X and he said, what do you think this means? And he said, just case chickens coming home to roost. That's how I see it. Got him fired from the Nation of Islam. Upset people then, but that's what I immediately flashed on. That's what just about everybody of color I've ever talked to flashed on. There's no wounded sense of pride involved in communities of color here, and there's no sense of national innocence being on the receiving end of what the nation does. Although it's not actually a nation, it's a proliferation of nations bound together by a statist centralist government at gunpoint, which is what states do, the imposition of arbitrary order by force, which is why you got more people proportionately in this country behind bars with Leonard than any other country on the planet. Pick your great demon state, your totalitarian state, none of them lock up as great a proportion of their population as this country does and convert them into virtual slave laborers, but that's another story. Chickens. Chickens might take us to motive if we view them in a certain way, because Malcolm wasn't talking about birds, not literally. He had something else in mind. And there's something else in mind that occurred to me. Well, let's call them ghosts or spirits, wraiths, ancestors, whatever your tradition, there's a word, but they're all going to come to the same place. There's more than just the people with the box cutters and the plane that are riding in on those aircraft. From a certain tradition, you could call it karma, I suppose, but I don't go there either because it's not mine. But now, whose ghosts or wraiths or spirits would we be talking about? Well, it occurred to me right off that you had a 500,000 plus Iraqi children who have been determined to have died needlessly, I think was the term applied in the report from the United Nations in 1996. Dead as a result of the effects of U.S. sanctions. No, not because Saddam Hussein siphoned off the oil for food money. That oil for food money wasn't even there. It began at the end of 96 as a UN response to the child mortality rates that were occurring under the sanctions in Iraq. So whatever corruption there was in the oil for food program happened after the fact. No, this is when the United States was imposing it through, using the UN as the surrogate, as the entity, as the media, was imposing a set of sanctions that it designed and enforced. And in 1996, on 60 Minutes, which is not exactly an obscure back channel community access sort of programming, okay, with an interview with Leslie Stahl, Madeleine Albright, who was at that time U.S. ambassador to the United Nations, responded to a question of whether she knew about this UN report, this estimation of the child fatalities, and she said, yes, we are aware, and we've determined it's worth the cost or worth the price, one or the other. Means the same thing, but I wouldn't want to misquote Madam Madeleine. Yes, we're aware and have determined it's worth the price in someone else's children in order to punctuate preceding president, father of the current president, George Herbert Walker Bush's articulation of the free world notion that what the world needs to understand is what we say goes. Quote, end quote. What we say goes. And you're not doing what you're told. You're unruly. You fought back. Well, here's how it works. We'll starve your children to death until you're ready to do what you're told. Well, this is under Clinton administration. And Madeleine Albright, having said that, goes on to become Secretary of State. She's actually promoted as a result of that. And American public, well, you all remember the mass demonstrations and professions of outrage that occurred at the end of 96, right? Million people on the mall in Washington, D.C. demanding an end to the sanctions, right? Yeah, you remember the same thing I did. Yawn. 500,000 children dead in a country of 20 million people. That's genocide. And the UN High Commissioner in charge of trying to mediate the effects of what the United States was doing, when Albright announced that, this probably was not the cause that precipitated his resignation, but it correlates fairly closely. Dennis Halliday resigns expressly for the reason that he's in his position, officially in the UN, unable to prevent or halt what he considers to be a policy of deliberate genocide being imposed. And yeah, absolutely no cognitive dissonance, not a ripple of unrest. What do you do when it's your children that are being determined to be worth the price? Do you stand out there and when you're done with the 3,000 names, you start reading theirs? Oh, hell no. They don't count. They don't count. They're not worthy of even missing a cappuccino break for. They're not us, whoever us might be. The us that's getting secured now. From whom? There's a whole lot of us we're getting secured from. Peel that onion, you end up with a pretty small core. It's being protected against everybody here as well as there to make sure that what it was that was being insured in Iraq through those means continues unimpaired. And that's, well, what the present president's daddy called the New World Order. There's another guy that talked about a New World Order sometime about 60 years ago. He's not much thought of fondly in certain circles, although he should be to all appearances, since they're trying to reproduce him without cloning in a context of a collective entity that they used to call the United States. What do you do if those are your children under those circumstances? And the people in whose name it's being done simply view it as a natural and irrelevant aspect of business as usual, guaranteeing stability in a region that is absolutely vital for the maintenance at a fairly low cost of what they take to be a divine entitlement to what they refer to as a quality of life, unexcelled. And we're back to cappuccinos and better cell phones and BMWs and 26-year-olds buying loft apartments in Soho's for $1.5 million and immediately having them gutted to spend $2 million to have them refurbished to a state of opulence that they find to be naturally befitting to their exalted selves while children starve. That's the trade-off. What do you do? Well, it occurred to me maybe that's what happened on 911. That's what you do. And that's probably what anybody would do placed in that position. It occurred to me that might be the case. Or it might be the case that someone was a little irritated about Palestinian kids get shot in the head for throwing rocks during the Intifada. Now, of course, the United States would not be directly involved in that, except that every round fired from an Israeli rifle is provided by the taxpayers of the United States. Most of the munitions and quite a lot of the hardware, and all of the political support and the immunization from refusal to adhere to the requirements of international law. That's all owing to the United States. That's all done in the name of the public of the United States, and the public of the United States' response to that being done is to vote for the people doing it over and over and over again. Oh yeah, I forgot. We do have choices. Quick poll of the room. How many of you voted Republican last time? Now let's see it for Demopublicans. Yeah. John Kerry. Now there's an alternative. I mean, I was with that lying son of a bitch in VVAW, and he sold us out clear back then, and that's an alternative? Yeah, I'll take George Bush, actually. I mean, at least he was a draft dodger. At least he did good dope. There's a whole lot of that old boy's youth he doesn't remember at all. Such was the quality of drugs that his daddy's oil profits could purchase for him. John Kerry, whose alternative was, I can do the same thing Bush is doing, but I can do it better and more efficiently than him, so vote for me. Yeah, vote for me, I'll set you free. Uh-huh. Tweedledee, Tweedledum. So it occurred to me, Palestinians probably were sending some ghosts along. See, there were those 500,000 Iraqi children. Well, actually, the UN report said 565,000 by that point. Now note, when the food for oil program began, whatever corruption was involved, that mortality rate went down dramatically. Whatever that thug that headed the Ba'athist Party may have done, he didn't starve his own children to death. The onus of that's right here. And there are about 500,000 adults that might have joined that queue on those aircraft as well. So add them to the list of chickens. And then add the Palestinians, all of them, over the last two generations, dispersed from, displaced from their homeland, complements of U.S. taxpayers, and cooped up in refugee camps when they're not being attacked wholesale, living that life generation in, generation out, with no end in sight. There might be a little irritation there. There might be a little holdover irritation from some Panamanians whose country was invaded lock, stock, and barrel. Regime change imposed in the name of the United States serving a drug warrant on a nominal head of state. There were a couple slit trenches full of bodies that were not supposed to have been accumulated as casualties, according to the Pentagon, during the fighting, were found afterwards. They're still living with that. Maybe they're irritated. Maybe they're irritated in some other places in Central America from, oh, that funny little Contra war that was waged down there illegally. Illegally even under U.S. law by the Reagan administration, piling up corpses. And remember the famous white paper about El Salvador while they were funding death squads and perpetrating wholesale massacres? Yeah. There might even be some Mayans who have come up here a little disgruntled by the fact that you had a duly elected democratic government in a place called Guatemala that was overthrown by the CIA in 1954 with the result that about 230,000 Mayan Indians have ended up getting slaughtered since, in order to pave the way for the opening up of their traditional homelands to make industrial parks for the greater glory of U.S. corporate profit. And the whole thing was undertaken back in 54 to guarantee the stability of the use of Guatemalan farmland for the profitability of United Fruit. And then there's something about the overthrow and of the duly elected government in Iran, compliments of Kermit Roosevelt. And there's a whole bunch of people that end up dead in Iran as a result of that, compliments of U.S. taxpayers once again in the operations of SAVAK to prevent them from having the government of their choice. But perhaps we've gone too far, because in between those two points I was just talking about, the Contra War in Nicaragua and the stuff that was happening in 1953 in Iran and 1954 in Guatemala, you had about 3.2 million, and that's according to defense Secretary McNamara in his memoirs that about 3.2 million Indochinese, in order to prevent those folks from electing Ho Chi Minh, which the Eisenhower government had a political study that said if we actually hold the election, we committed, that we are committed to honor, according to the Geneva Accords, in that country. Ho Chi Minh is the only possible winner. He would be elected. You can't allow them to elect somebody that we don't like, and therefore, in order to keep them free, you understand. Yeah, well, I was involved in that one, and that was the one I'm going to spend the rest of my life living down, I would suppose. I got some karma to pay there, too, using that term again. But maybe there's a few people my age who are on the receiving end of that exercise in free world dynamics who have not quite gotten over what it was that was done to their country and still being done, because a lot of the stuff, cluster bombs and so forth, are still detonating and taking children's feet off and farmers' feet off in the rice paddies over there, and you've still got buried defoliants that are being brought to the surface, which are both carcinogenic, mutagenic, and all manner of other ecocidal environmental devastation that has effects on flora, fauna, including the human population. And this is 35 years after the fact. They're still paying the cost and the consequences. The United States did not even pay the reparations, paltry as they were, that they agreed to in order to be able to achieve what Richard Nixon called peace with honor. Thought maybe it had something to do with a half million to a million Indonesians that while Vietnam was going on, ended up getting slaughtered in order to take Sukarno out and put Suharto in. Suharto, the guy who just left Indonesia a couple, 3 years ago with about $20 billion of his impoverished people's aid money in his back pocket and is being protected by the United States. Still. And then that places the onus of East Timor and the slaughter of a third of the population there to maintain the stability of the Suharto regime in its late phases. Maybe those ghosts were involved. Then we could go back to Hiroshima and Nagasaki, but we should stop in Korea along the way and pay heed and homage to Nogun Ri and the other massacres that were perpetrated by U.S. forces there in order to maintain a partition line in somebody else's country in the name of freedom once again. The United States cutting somebody's country in half and saying, people don't agree with us, I have to stay north, and we're going to have the free world in the south, whether you like it or not. And if you don't like it, we'll kill you. Which they did. But Hiroshima and Nagasaki, 200,000 odd people incinerated in targets that had not been hit. Those cities were selected because they were relatively undamaged and overwhelmingly civilian in their utilization. Okay, these were a demonstration to Joe Stalin by Harry Truman, prefiguring George Bush's 1991 statement. This one's in 1945. Joe, we got weapons that you can't match in the post-war world, so you got to get the message, what we say goes. It wasn't about ending the war. They've been trying to end the war for 6 months. That had to do with the post-war order. 200,000 people were the form of the message sent. What's that great term that was invented on the 11th of September, 2001? You didn't find it in dictionary until then. Innocent American, that's all one word. Innocent American, if you're American by definition, you're innocent. Well, here's some samples of American innocence coming at you here. Because these are not evil demons lurking in the high quarters of empire or the back rooms of corporate America. This is getting done by your average on-the-ground American from Illinois like me. Nothing special and nothing innocent. Innocence and America are a contradiction in terms, oxymoronic. But they fused the two. You couldn't say American without innocent for 6 months after 9-1-1. And these were the least innocent of the lot. I'll come back to that too. Because of nuclear bombings, oh yeah, we're in Iraq now because they were really worried that there was WMD, which wasn't there. Worried about WMD in the country with the largest stockpiles of every known type of WMD in violation of every conceivable treaty. They're destroying the chemical weapons we never had now. Down at Skull Valley, largest inventories on the planet. could have killed an entire continental population with stuff the United States insisted it didn't have, and they're worried about what it was that the Ba'athists in Iraq might have made, given equipment and techniques by the United States to use as a counter against the Iranians at a certain point when Saddam was our friend. That was when he gassed the Kurds, you know. Nobody said a word about it when he did it. And he couldn't have done it without U.S. technical expertise and the provision of proscribed materials. That's reasonably well documented. Do an Amazon search on that very thing, a couple keywords, okay? You'll get the documents. They're U.S. documents. Of course, CIA must have been wrong with it, but in their reports for the 1980s, because they became very inconvenient in the 1990s. And you know, after all, how incompetent they are. You want to hang your entire security hat on them. For the nuclear bombings, and those nuclear bombings represent the only time any country has ever used nuclear weapons against another country. You're in it. It's not some evil empire out there. This is the one that's used the weapons of mass destruction on civilian targets. But that wasn't the worst of it. Now, for 2 years before that, Curtis LeMay's technicians have been out in the Utah and Nevada desert building simulations of Japanese neighborhoods, wood and paper cities inhabited by civilians, and they were testing various types of incendiaries under various atmospheric conditions in order to figure out where they would get the best burn patterns to take out massive sections of populated areas. And that's the Tokyo fire raid, for example. 120,000 people cremated in one night. And this was not a military installation. And when the British were doing that to the Germans, which they did, the United States objected vociferously, refused to participate, did daylight bombing with the 8th Air Force. But you want to talk about innocent civilian targets, you ask the Germans what the 8th Air Force did to them. When the Germans were acting aggressive, expanding, establishing a new world order and announcing to everyone in sight what we say goes, and slaughtering massive numbers of people in order to put themselves in the station that they had announced for themselves they were entitled to above, that's what Übermensch means, everyone else. And I don't hear too many good Americans with red, white, and blue banners standing out there condemning the 8th Air Force for being terrorists and obliterating German cities, daylight bombing or not. And I certainly don't hear them talking about what was done to the Japanese in over 100 cities in LeMay's fire raids of 1944 and 45. I have no idea how many people died as a result of that. The people who were the planners actually stated for the record they wanted to kill every single Japanese. And yes, I'm aware of Pearl Harbor and the 2,500 sailors or whatever it was. And yes, I'm aware of Nanking, neither of which excuse what I'm talking about here in any way at all. And we can roll it back. We can jump a little bit. We can jump to the turn of the century, to the last of the Indian Wars, which was not fought against Indians in the United States. It was against people that were called the Indians of the Philippines. On the far side of the Pacific, when the United States invaded to liberate those islands from the Spanish Empire, in order to turn it into its own colony for a forward strategic basing area for the next half century. They killed 600,000 to 1.5 million, what they pejoratively referred to as Moros. Hell Roaring Jake Smith, general in charge who had made his bones in the actual Indian Wars over here, proudly announced that he'd turned the most populous province in the island of Luzon, which was the most populous island of the entire Philippines, into what he referred to as a howling wilderness, that there were no people left in it at all. He had placed a bounty on the heads of every male over 10 years of age. That was the policy they don't teach you about in American history class, whether it's at the university level here or in your high school or your grade school. And if it's your grade school, you were too young to know. So they just don't talk about it, or they pretend the opposite of what it was that happened happened. The opposite of everything in American history is true. That's the way they'll teach it to you. Yeah, probably kids are too young. When you're 6 and 7 years old, you shouldn't have to be exposed to this kind of vile stuff that I'm talking about tonight. But I got to ask a question. I got to return to education every once in a while in the course of every time I talk. Why is it, do you think, children are always too young to hear the truth, but never too young to be lied to systematically, conscientiously, in the name of education? When you're talking about the Philippines, that begins in 1898. And that's 8 years after Wounded Knee and that mass grave that was photographed when they were dumping the bodies of the 350 Lakota old men, women and children, children that had been chased down in the snow 3 miles, coaxed into coming out and then beaten to death with rifle butts because they didn't want to waste the bullets, having cut the bulk of the people apart with Hotchkiss guns, unarmed and dismounted, immobilized, sitting duck targets, fired on from high ground by troops who got 30 medals of honor for this massacre. Yeah, they actually were awarded medals of honor for butchering women and children and dumping the bodies into a slit trench where they still in that mass grave to this very day. That was photographed. You take the photographs of them dumping those bodies of those Lakotas into that trench and you put them up against pictures of Einsatz Group and doing their operations in Eastern Europe, shooting Jews in the back of the head and dumping their bodies into anti-tank ditches, and people get confused as which image is which. Yeah, these are separated in time. That was a long time before Hitler. I'll tell you what, Hitler came to power in 1932. Wounded Knee was in 1890. 42 is not a very long number of, or a very great number of years. I'm a little older than that. I mean, it would be within the span of my lifetime. Those are contemporaneous events, and he learned from what was done here what it was he was going to do there, and said so. No reason for him to lie about it. These are in the early days. He knew what he was basing his model on. Did he have it right? Did he have it wrong? Well, hell, I think he probably knew more about American history than most Americans do. You read his books, it suggests that he was a student of it, and most Americans aren't. In fact, most Americans aren't much students of anything. Most Americans can't remember anything longer than 15 minutes. And part of the reason for that is it's continuously fragmented in the way I was talking about. And when you do hear something, it's a runaway bride and who killed JonBenet Ramsey and should Scott Peterson get the death penalty and who really gives a good goddamn anyway. But once you're in that Indian massacre there, at Wounded Knee, and that actually wasn't the last of the Indian wars. I mean, the U.S. had Marines down in Mexico put down a Yaqui attempt to establish a free state in 1914. And that's simply a fact. And the fact that somebody drew this funny little line that Arnold Schwarzenegger wants to defend with your lives across the Sonora Desert doesn't alter the fact that those are Indians down there, and that's U.S. Indian policy when it's projected abroad, just the same as when it does here, because Indians are other countries, and it was always abroad when they projected that kind of military power against us. They don't teach you, well, they're telling you to uphold the Constitution, what the Constitution actually says, does it? Anybody out there, anybody, faculty, student, community member, good red, white, and blue-blooded American Republican, want to tell me what the 10th section of the first article of the Constitution says? Quick, quick, quick. Y'all ready to go die or kill other people? To defend the damn thing, you ought to know what it says. Fire away back there. We got a volunteer. I like volunteers. Airborne. You're going to be in the Army tomorrow morning. Right, you're right. You're reading it. What, do you carry the Constitution around with you? Good for you, man. You take it seriously. Y'all ought to do that. They have pocket editions. You can actually explain the law to the cops when they start to enforce it on you, okay? Real handy thing to have, Constitution of the United States. 10th article, or 10th section of the first article says that in order for the federal government, and that's the only entity in the United States can enter into a treaty relation, in order for it to lawfully enter into a treaty relation, the other party has to be a sovereign entity on same footing as itself. It can't enter into treaties with states. It can't enter into treaties with provinces and counties and municipalities, boards of regent, PTA groups, or anything else other than another sovereign nation. Note, it cannot, in effect, enter into treaties with subparts of itself. Think about that next time you want to talk about American Indians with treaties being just another part of the United States, and they ought to get over and get used to it. That's an illegal statement. It's contrary to the Constitution itself. Of course, your judges don't understand that, so it might be on you to educate them. You being non-Indians, it's your constitution. We entered into compacts with you. just thought I would demonstrate my conservative credentials, because I'm way more conservative. Everything I talk about is based on law. I'm way more conservative than those people out there. And that's a fact. But you going back from Wounded Knee to the Marias River, to the Washita River, to the Sapa Creek, to the Slim Buttes, to the Sand Creek, to the Horseshoe Bend, to the Tallahassee River. You're going back to the Mystic Massacre. You're going all the way back in an uninterrupted string of massacres and scalp bounties and dislocations and reductions of population, liquidations as they called them in Europe, all the way back to an outfit called the Wappingers. Well, they didn't call themselves the Wappingers. But if you've heard of them at all, it would be by that name, because that's the European name, the name that Europeans put on them to record them in history. But they're not much talked about because what happened with them is not too convenient. And we don't like to talk about what's inconvenient in this country. In fact, we want to, I don't know, take people, tie them to a stake, burn them up for saying wrong things. Okay, you'd be accused of white bashing when you talk about what white people do. You'd be talking about being anti-American when you talk about the history of the United States. Knowing something about it is considered unpatriotic. Wappingers. Could probably actually find a name, but I've never encountered it and don't know anybody who knows. They're pretty much lost in the mist of history. And these are the guys, you all heard about them, I'm sure, in grade school. These silly Indians that sold Manhattan Island to the Dutch for a handful of beads and trinkets. Silly Indians. Manhattan Island. Tell you what, they said that was about $50 worth of beads and trinkets. We'll pay you about $50 billion to keep that monstrosity you've created on Manhattan Island. We want the land back, but not that. Okay? No, these are those very little Indians of Americana. Okay, so little Indians sold the island. No, they didn't. They rented the tip of the island to the Dutch for trading purposes because it was of mutual benefit. Trade had things like bladed weapons, iron pots, glass beads, trade cloth, things Indians didn't have. These are trading people. They had things the Dutch didn't have but coveted, beaver pelts, for example. But in order to engage in this commerce on any regular basis, the Dutch, who were from somewhere else, needed to have some place to set up, so the Indians rented them some land. The Dutch being, oh, you always mispronounce our name, so let me return the compliment and say of a very European persuasion, decided that since these are inferiors, they would simply pass off this rental agreement as a bill of sale. When the Indians objected, they solved the problem. The way they solved it was by rounding up the militia, sending them up the island to dispense with the Wappingers, which they did with remarkable efficiency, so efficient that they didn't believe that they would believed when they came back. When they came back down to New Amsterdam, as they called it, they didn't believe that the townspeople would believe they'd actually done. Oh yeah, sure, now we'll have to deal with the Indians again next year. So, in order to document their achievement, they took the heads from the recognizable males, the ones who were prominent, with whom people at New Amsterdam had dealt, or who at least they'd seen. They took their heads and they produced them in town, said, yeah, we've vanquished the Wappingers. Basically, we've annihilated them, and here's the proof. And there was a joyous upsurge of sentiment among the populace. And they were so happy, they celebrated, and they celebrated by having themselves a sporting contest, jolly little game of kickball, using the Indians' heads as the ball. Produced them in town, said, yeah, we've vanquished the Wappingers. Basically, we've annihilated them, and here's the proof. And there was a joyous upsurge of sentiment among the populace. And they were so happy, they celebrated, and they celebrated by having themselves a sporting contest, a jolly little game of kickball, using the Indians' heads as the balls. And that little kickball contest happened at a location which is very nearly the foundation of the World Trade Center. Military economic interlock as a matter of state has been the nature of this project we now call the United States since before the United States ever existed. Doing this to other people is the absolute fundamental requirement of what it is that becomes the United States. That whole process of what was done to Indians in terms of liquidation of population and divestiture of land and resources was the absolutely essential ingredient of placing the United States in a position to where it could project itself outward in the world in the same fashion it had projected itself inward to consolidate itself as a continental block country, a mega state, as it were. There's no distinction to be drawn in terms of form or motive between what it is that the United States is doing in Iraq today and about 30 other places on the planet, and what it's been doing throughout the 20th century abroad, and what it was that it had to do internal to the North American continent in order to create the capacity to do that. Inside, the outside are inextricably linked. It's a single, uninterrupted process. Now, all of those people from all of those massacres and all of those scalp bounties and all of those dislocations and dying of disease from smallpox infection that was deliberately induced in California and the upper Missouri and the Ohio River Valley and elsewhere, they were all there. They were all there on 9-1-1. These were all unrequited deaths, actually even celebrated, because that's orthodox historiography. American historiography is ultimately triumphalist. It is the same kind of history you could expect a victorious Germany to have written about itself in the aftermath of the Second World War. Germany, however, was not as smart as the Nordic population of North America, as Hitler called y'all. It lost. That's the big difference. Germany lost. The Nordics here didn't. Other than that, well, we can parse differences all day long, but it's the commonalities which are actually ultimately at issue. And it doesn't end with the Indians. Those foundations of those buildings, the World Trade Center, sit roughly, as those of you who have been to New York probably know, roughly at the foot of something called Wall Street. Wall Street, which takes its name from the enclosure of the slave market, which gave rise to the New York economy. No. Slavery was not something restricted to the Deep South. It was in the North too, and it was very profitable to trade in human flesh, chattel laborers, livestock, in other words, drawn out of African civilizations. And so the U.S. portion of the transatlantic slave trade would also be at issue. Those people who died in the Middle Passage en route to North America, with the markets in New York and Charleston and elsewhere, those who were brought here too, because for their own civilizations, for their own cultures, their own societies, they were as good as dead. They weren't killed, and that's the big distinction that the exclusivists will tell you. Well, this wasn't really genocide because they weren't killing them. In fact, they had a vested interest in keeping them alive as much as possible because they were valuable and they wanted to work them. They needed the labor. Didn't matter back home. Once you're taken across an ocean and pressed into chattel slavery, never to return, you might as well be dead. The impact on your culture is the same. And then there's all those guys that didn't have a Chinaman's chance of surviving. You've heard that expression? That's another good bit of Americana. They haven't got a Chinaman's chance getting through that one, buddy. The reference there comes to the coolie labor that was expendable, imported into this country to lay track on the Transcontinental Railroad and to do the dangerous work in the deep shaft mines in California, in South Dakota, and elsewhere. You don't have a Chinaman's chance refers to their life expectancy. Nobody kept them alive or even tried to because they were of no value. They could be replaced so cheaply and so easily. Work them to death in a hurry and replace them with someone else. Oh yeah, they were there too. and all the, what is it they call them, wetbacks? Yeah, wetbacks getting across a river that this country that we're in imposed upon another country as it gobbled up the northern half of that other country. Oh yeah, you're gonna turn people into migrant laborers, virtual slave laborers, and so forth as an onus for crossing a river to get back home. And that's really what that comes down to. That whole mishmash, that whole nightmare, that all came to bear. Large boil, lanced, pus splatters. That's what I saw as being possibly the motive. Because there is a sort of an intuitive consciousness of all this if you're not a part of a self-anointed master race. And that's who it is that we're talking about when we're talking about the need for security. Go down to one of these LA gated communities and see who it is that's being secured in from what. When they're talking about our security, they're not talking about us. They're talking about them and securing themselves from us. Yeah. Us got more in common with your average Iraqi, Palestinian, Indo-Chinese, and so on than we ever had with a George Bush or a Dick Cheney. And that's simply a natural fact. And there are a whole lot of white people that fit that description of being people of color, too. You can ask people in Appalachia about that one. Okay, Scotch-Irish, internal colonized coal miners sent down and expendable too. So just because you're white, don't be foolish enough to think that they won't use you like toilet paper. It comes expedient to keeping their quality of life up to tune, okay? You can't get people across the Rio Grande, they're gonna be turning you into their gardeners, okay? I slipped there, that's actually real bravo, isn't it? And Rio Bravo is not just a John Wayne movie. That's somebody else's name for that river, and that's somebody else. Well, now. Understand the nature of it. As long as you're acting this way in the world, or this country is acting this way in the world, and doing so in your name, and you're not responding, you're going to be subject to this kind of attack, and that's a natural phenomenon. Anyone placed in that position would respond the same way. Hey, the guys have been trying to shoot me. Oh yeah, they canceled that one up there in Hamilton on serious grounds. The JTTF decided they couldn't secure that one. That was in New York State, and that was at the front end of this thing. And they just validated my point all to hell and gone. I said, what you do is you have people either in direct proximity that you love, that you revere, that are a part of your life, or that symbolically fulfill that role, and you have them slaughtered violently. And then you have people that you associate with those who slaughter them, speak of them in a way that seems to devaluate, demean, degrade, dehumanize them to the point of, oh, I don't know, let's just pick a term out of, you probably heard this one on CNN, collateral damage. You compound the agony of their loss with that kind of behavior, and they will try to kill you. And good Americans will do that just as fast as Arabs. And those good Americans in New York proved the point. They felt that I had demeaned, even dehumanized, those they loved, although that sounds like I'm laying it on the families, and to my knowledge, the families weren't involved. It was people acting in the name of the families who were attempting to kill me, doing exactly what it was those Arabs had done, right down to the point of acting in the names of the victims. Much has been made of the fact that nobody on those aircraft was actually Iraqi, so how could they be responding for the deaths of the Iraqi children? And the point was, you don't have to be in that kind of direct proximity. If you got a shred of humanity and children are being eradicated, people are being killed for things that you cannot countenance, you will respond if there's no alternative made available to you, if there is no sort of cognitive dissonance in the perpetrator society about the perpetration of the deed, you will kill them. Simple equation. Now we've got an understanding of the substance of terrorism. In order to be able to deal with any phenomenon, you first have to be able to understand it. That's my explanation of it. You can accept it, you can reject it, but that's what that articulation was about. Having defined the phenomenon, the question then What do you do about it? Because there was all that hoo-ha about security. Okay, and the security is going to be hanged on an analysis of the events that you can counterpose to my own that I just handed you. You heard it at length. Now, let me give you the other side verbatim. Well, they did it because they're evil. They hate freedom. They're evil. They hate freedom. They hate freedom. They're evil. Evil. Freedom. Hate it. No. Yeah. Oh. Ain't. Sound bites. Absolutely devoid of anything analytically useful at all. And from there, you're going to get a security system that works on the basis of what? Invading other countries and multiplying the degree of resentment, the pain, the anguish. Continue to refer to those who are slaughtered as collateral damage. Talking about their deaths and immiseration as if it was of a benefit to them rather than you. That's going to solve the problem. You're going to do it by greater degree of firepower, the cloning out of Delta units and special operations groups and proliferating them around the planet, by curtailing rights and liberties here and pounding tweezers at airports. You remember the last time those terrorists got on a plane and got the stewardess down and were tweezing her eyebrows until she screamed for mercy and said, "I'll fly the plane into the building. Just stop tweezing me." Charged a guy down in, somewhere around Orange County, an Asian guy that was pissed off at his boss, built a pipe bomb. They hauled him in and charged him with possession of a weapon of mass destruction. I'm not making this up. Going absolutely Looney Tunes on the home front. More SWAT teams, more cops running around wearing black military uniforms with boots. More firepower than the average city police force than most third world armies. Licensing torture. Gitmo and its camps and camps you've never heard of in about 30 countries around the world. And on and on and on. You want to hang your security on that because it comes out of that funny little analysis about their evil and hate freedom. So let's see. To secure ourselves against that evil that hates freedom, we'll abolish freedom here and then every place else as a progressive gesture, okay, and turn the whole thing into this absolutely lockstep, regimented, orderly conflagration in the name of... Fill in the blank for me here, somebody. We got a bright audience. These are all students. In the name of what? Yeah, right. You want to see how that works? I got a real good idea for you. Get on your long-distance line and call a random Israeli, because they got the world's most highly developed security state of that type. They've got borders much shorter and easily defensible than you have in North America for the United States, and they got a relatively homogeneous population. And the last time I heard, you got 14-year-old kids walking in with bundles of dynamite strapped to their body and blowing Israelis right out the window of their cafes. You want to hang your hat for security on that? Well, if so, leave me out. And leave my kids and the rest of my family out too. Go ahead and give it a roll. And don't complain in the aftermath. Or you could try a different way. What would the different way look like? Since you know the nature of the phenomenon generating the response, maybe security would be to convince those on the receiving end of American benevolence out there in the world that you suddenly don't devalue and demean and degrade them as a matter of consciousness, and that you actually would treat them as human beings rather than dehumanizing, probably indict people who referred to them as collateral damage, that actually what it is that the United States has defined itself in the world as being is the opposite of what it will be in the future. Maybe if you could convince them of that, they wouldn't be planning to fly planes into your buildings and have you jumping 1,000 feet on fire. Maybe. But how would you do that? Because the United States has always proceeded on the noblest of rhetoric. I mean, my God, I wish I'd written some of that prose. The gulf between the rhetoric and reality has always been as wide as the Pacific Ocean, but the rhetoric is sounding good. Probably more rhetoric is not going to get it. I got the chancellor, interim chancellor, DeStefano of my own university, demanding that I come in with a proof of pedigree card and established before a racial board, a board of racial purity, apparently the fact of my identity, while he writes glowing editorials that are published in the press about the need to combat racism on campus. And put those two pieces together and see what kind of cognitive dissonance you get. That's the same guy in the same week. And that's emblematic of the whole. So no, more rhetoric's not gonna get it. How might you actually do it? Well, I had a really, really radical suggestion. This is what drives the Republicans crazy. I mean, they just go frothing at the mouth, scratching like cats climbing right up the wall. Because here's the radical crux of my proposition of how to ensure security for the American public and a whole bunch of other people while we're at it. Let's pretend, just for a moment, because that allows for consciousness. If you got the consciousness, you got the possibility of concretizing that consciousness in terms of action. Let's just pretend for a moment altogether that the United States of America and the government thereof were required, just like everyone and every other entity on the planet, to obey the law. Man, now there's a radical concept, flaming anti-American. Government of the United States might have to obey the law, obey the law, obey the law. What's it called? This is a command, a cry, an appeal, an insistence. Take all those words, stack them up, and then put them in front or behind or above law enforcement. I demand law enforcement, beginning with the big laws on the big entities first and then having a little trickle-down effect from there. What are you talking about, obey the law? We got no smoking signs plastered on every flat surface in California. And we can tell the government officials, cops are not even allowed to smoke in their cars anymore. Nobody, government officials included, except Arnold Schwarzenegger in the governor's office with his cigars, smokes in any public place. We're all obeying the law. No, I'm not talking about these petty regulatory things that they pass off as being laws. That's what they've got you indoctrinated to look at law as being, these little things that regulate every waking and sleeping moment of your life. Buckle up, it's the law. No smoking, it's the law. Cross between the lines, it's a law. No, let's try the one that says the United States cannot lawfully engage in military action abroad without the approval of the United Nations Security Council. Let's start with that one. Let's try the one that says non-proliferation of nuclear weapons applies to the United States as well as it applies to North Korea, Iran, and Iraq. So University of California, Lawrence Livermore Lab are going to have to look for another place to attract revenue than in producing a new generation of bunker buster munitions. Let's consider the depleted uranium ammunition is nuclear weapons, okay, because it has the same effect. Not the Big Bang, but it just proliferates radiation and somebody else is paying the consequences, because when the United States is done using their armor-piercer stuff in their homeland, they have to stay there and live with it. But there's more than a few U.S. troops that have found out what that does to you, too. They call it the Gulf War Syndrome. Oh, yeah, they can't figure out what that is, just like they couldn't figure out what the effects of dioxin were on U.S. troops. The stuff that we were exposed to and Agent Orange, it took them 30 years of denying it had any effect. Meanwhile, they can tell you within a tenth of a decimal point how many people are going to die of environmental tobacco smoke exposure and worldwide over the next year. And if you believe that, you come see me about this junk car I got, okay? Because you're going to pay big bucks because it's a collector's item, I'm sure. Oh, yeah. I notice the laughter in California goes off when you start talking about that, all right? You got people living down there in Los Angeles where, I don't know if you actually keep track of the environmental data from LA, but the atmospheric conditions are such so that you're gonna take a newborn baby, never expose them to tobacco smoke, okay, and in 2 weeks gonna have a lifetime exposure to about 70 different atmospheric toxins, saturation point. And in that cesspool of toxins. They're going to worry about poor people's social habits as being a class 1 or class A or whatever they call it, carcinogen, and abolish social space. Oh, yeah. Oh, I see people sitting out there squirming now. Mass murder and genocide, man. Go, go. Don't you talk about cigarettes. Don't you talk about cigarettes like maybe there's something bizarre about our attitude toward them. Living in the shadow of a nuclear reactor at San Luis Obispo and not wanting you to smoke a cigarette on the street. Okay. Yeah, I got it. I got it. See, it's almost impossible to unpack the pathologies that make up the composition of the American zeitgeist, okay, but denial is certainly one of them. All right, diversion's another. All right, we're dying, plutonium all around us, we're living in a virtual plutonium dump, so let's not allow anybody to smoke. Woo. So you have to kind of get off that onto something a little more real before anybody's going to treat you credibly, no matter what you say out in the world. Yeah, how about the Geneva Conventions? Don't we have an attorney general, not the one in California, although he'd probably agree, but the one in Washington, D.C., the guy that thinks the Geneva Conventions are obsolete, he's the guy who wrote the draft on licensure of torture. Then you got Viet Dinh down here in San Diego, is that where he's living now, the guy who drafted the Patriot Act? He's a miracle worker. Anybody ever see the Patriot Act? Actually look at the thing? Looks like telephone book for San Francisco. And he wrote that in 30 days. Yeah, right. Perhaps 911 was a pretext to get something passed they had as a shopping list for repression that had been sitting on the shelf there accumulating pages for about 10, 15, 20 years. Yeah. The Patriot Act, my ass. That was basically the final stroke of the repeal of the Constitution of the United States, in case you hadn't noticed, but they call it the Patriot Act. George Orwell must be doing big spins in the grave. Let's try the Constitution of the United States. Maybe we would try adhering to that a little bit. Let's reinstate it. Let's demand that the government reinstate it. Yeah? These are not guidelines. And I suggest maybe we start at the beginning of the Constitution with a reinstatement, which means the first article. You want to take a look at those Indian treaties? Some of this law enforcement business might start right here where you live. Somebody got 26,000 odd acres over there that was Fort Ord when I was being transshipped to Southeast Asia. That was the transshipment point. Okay, Fort Ord's where they sent the body bags back to. 26,000 acre abandoned military compound. There's a law in the books that said military installations when abandoned revert to first usage claims by native population. What is the local native population got out of Fort Ord upon request? As I understand it, originally the offer of 11 acres, which was rescinded in favor of a housing development, and they gave them 45 acres, is still under negotiation at the present time. Out of 26,000 acres! That's not only non-compliance on a treaty that wasn't ratified, but upon which they predicate title. Hell, that's a transgression of federal law in a statutory sense. And I know right here in Monterey, you've had mass demonstrations supporting Native people in order to ensure that they get their rights. Your government will adhere to the rule of law as it articulates and as sounds so good when they read it on the books. Is that right? Yeah, that's what I figured. I can run it down all night. You got a thing out there that is ratified. And the sixth article of the Constitution says that a treaty once ratified supreme law of the land. So we're talking big time law when we're talking about that in the domestic terms, but it's also international law because it's a compact between nations. So you got the Vienna Convention from 1969, Vienna Convention on Law of Treaties at issue, and the U.S. are breaches of that. But you got things that have been ratified, like the Universal Declaration on the Elimination of All Forms of Racial Discrimination. You think you got some work to do with that one? That goes to the Ninth Amendment of the U.S. Constitution, which says that all the rights that are not otherwise delineated in the Bill of Rights are vested right there in that one. Okay, human rights are rights. They're vested in the Ninth Amendment. So those human rights are not just international legal rights, they're constitutional rights. It's about time you started supporting them, insisting on them, asserting them, exerting them. pretending to be citizens. Citizens do more than wave flags and count bodies and sing songs. They actually comport themselves in the world by keeping their government on a leash. That's how you turn it around. It's not a quick fix. It's not a pill you can take. There's not a petition you can send to Osama bin Laden or whoever his replacement would be this week that's going to get the job done. There's not a glowing statement you can make. There's not a course you can teach or a teaching you can attend. There's not a new musical form or a recording studio you can go to, not a hairstyle, not a clothing style, no dietary change, no marches, no parades. It's going to take consistent confrontation with the forces of illegality, which unfortunately for the American public, they've allowed to become the government and its entity, its enforcement entities within the United States, and slug it out in a perfectly painful and protracted process to restore the power to the citizens that were vested by the founders in the citizenry. There's a default in the name of creature comfort that's occurred. I would go back to Jefferson and said something about, oh, some poli-sci or political philosophy professor out there, correct me if I get this paraphrase too off, but it was something about the citizens were obligated to abolish the government, dissolve it by whatever means were necessary about once every 20 years in order to keep it from overweening and basically usurping the rights of the citizens. Now, if I remember right, that would mean you're about 200 years overdue. But I'm not a revolutionary. I'll leave that to Jefferson and the other guys who would be down there at Gitmo getting interrogated to find out what their terrorist intentions were towards the body politic of sheep out here who are busily walking between the lines and bleeding wildly for someone to make sure they do the same tomorrow. Just make sure I'm safe while I do what I'm told and I'll call myself free. Thank you very much and even amen. Speaking of amen, you know, funny thing happened on the way to this particular situation in my life, and I'm going to switch over to the academic thing, what the agenda is, and trying to shut me up other than the fact that Bill O'Reilly doesn't want to talk to me anymore. Okay? But when I framed this thing the way I did with the little Eichmanns, and I suppose I need to say something about that and all the rest of it, I never used words like deserved. Hell, I'm not even sure Eichmann deserved it because I don't know what the moral standing was of the entity that hanged him, but if there was an entity with the moral standing to hang anybody, that was probably it. And I've called for a few people to be hanged myself, but I don't think I can remember a point where I ever called for anybody, Nazi or otherwise, to be put to death by being forced to jump out a window on fire from 1,000 feet up. I'm usually talking about shooting or hanging or something a little more direct and immediate than the kind of death that was suffered on 9-1-1. So I never said anybody deserved it, and I never really used the word Nazi. I used something pretty specific in that sense, but at the time I was saying it, there were a couple other guys that were saying it just that way, about the people who died on 9-1-1 deserving it. And I can put names to that. One of them was Pat Robertson, and the other one was Jerry Falwell. Now, I think they had something else in mind. They were worried about people's sex lives and stuff, and because of people's sex lives and preferences and such didn't conform to their own notion of rigidity and order and ubermensch mentality, they were corrupt and venal and therefore deserved the death they got. They actually said that. I didn't. And I don't see any mass protests by self-proclaimed patriots outside podium where they are speaking then or now. But when you break down what I did say, it was do unto others as you would have them do unto you. That's the real simple biblical turn of the whole thesis that I put forth. Now I figured that wasn't really all that hard to digest, although my way of framing it's a little alien to people who read scripture. Okay? It's a little rough. I'll grant you that, but it's really not all that deep. You can do it. But of course, first you'd have to read it, wouldn't you? And that seems to be a no-no on the right. Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. I figured at least one of them would be able to read it, understand it, and all of a sudden I'd be a hero of the Christian right. Oh, naive little me. I thought they actually meant it. But of course, You know as well as I do that they don't. That's a charade too, just like the rest of this patriotism that goes in the name of democracy, freedom, and the rest of that. They don't mean it for a moment. So what's this about? This is the last little phase, and then we can get down and wallow in the mud or whatever it is we're going to do here. Questions, answers, spit, wads, whatever. What is this about? The lab test failed and so forth, but why did they attempt it? What really is the agenda here? Because you know I'm not the only one. I got converted into being a sort of the poster boy for academic freedom, which was never a role I signed for myself. There's actual work I want to be doing, and I've been totally preempted in doing that work ever since January as a result of this agenda that they set on me, not the other way around. And the process has sort of been lost. There's a Professor Alim at Northeastern University and three junior professors of Arabic studies at Columbia University and a couple guys in Florida and so on and so on. They're targeted for elimination as well. What's the agenda? And actually, why the particular focus I'd be? Well, I know he's ethically impaired, but you don't have to consider him consistently a liar. Every once in a while, he's talking about what has meaning to him, and then he tells the truth about it when he thinks he can get away with it. The guy's name is Newt Gingrich. You've heard of him. Newt Gingrich went on Joe Scarborough early on in this thing and basically just announced the agenda, and then it was sort of reiterated several times in variations by other people of, I don't know whether you call this stature or not, but they're fairly heavy hitters on that side of the equation. The interlock between ACTA, which my governor is on the board of, by the way, Lynn Cheney's organization, and Gingrich is a piece of that, and William Bennett. So you got that sort of cluster, if you will, of educational giants. Newt put it pretty clearly. This is the kickoff to a national campaign to roll up this kind of critical engagement. Because this guy, Churchill, he said, was the chairman of ethnic studies, University of Colorado. They actually had him being chairman. He's a full professor. He's tenured and he's a chair. It's not just Churchill. They need to be getting rid of that whole damn department, ethnic studies, and not just at Colorado. And it's not just ethnic studies, it's women's studies, and it's queer studies, and it's post-colonial studies, and it's subaltern studies, and it's cultural studies in general. It's any kind of pocket within the more established disciplines that engages in critical engagement with the status quo. That's just to be eliminated because it's un-American and intolerable, and the taxpayers should not have to be subsidizing it. These guys are free to speak on a soapbox down the street. We're not going to impair their free speech. They just not should not be allowed to be employed in institutions. This should be eliminated from the institutions altogether. And you want to try speaking on a soapbox anyplace in California, you better go get a license. Because you're not free to speak on a soapbox. You're not free to assemble. You have to have a permit. Excuse me, sir, could I have a permit to exercise my rights? What time can I do that and where? Man, Jefferson must be rolling right around with Orwell about now. Where we have come here in this country. And note, I'm in it too. Of course, I suppose if I said I wasn't, if I were to stand here and renounce my citizenship tonight, say I never asked for it in the first place, it's something you imposed upon me, what would they do with me? Deport my ass to Oklahoma? So that's the go-away side. That's sort of subtraction. That's the purge agenda, for lack of a better term. And they've all iterated it. Interestingly enough, David Horowitz, my favorite ungraduated academic expert who has never published a refereed piece of anything at any point in his life, but going to explain exactly how higher education should be reorganized from his position of monumental competence to speak on it. He initially joined that course and then said, no, wait a minute. I don't want anybody losing their job here. I'm magnanimous, you know. I can't figure out what my ideology is from one moment to the next. I'm a Stalinist traitor in one decade, and I'm somewhere to the right of Attila the Hun in the next, and you should trust me because I zig and I zag all over the goddamn place. I announced myself self-concept having been a traitor to the United States in the 1960s, but rather than going to prison, like a man of integrity would do if he actually believed what he was saying, rather than ingratiating himself to a new audience, he goes out and becomes a hero of the right on the basis of his treason. Really interesting country we inhabit here. Well, David zigged and zagged on this and decided that what we really needed was more people like him in the academy and to balance out people like me that are in the academy, neglecting to mention that I offered him a job when he ran at RAP, the University of Colorado, and he turned and ran. The last thing he wants is to actually be pinned down for more than 15 minutes on a campus where he might have to answer some questions and be subject to the inconsistencies of his argument being addressed and have to respond in depth to questions about what it is of a factual nature that he's basing his positions on. So another little hoax. In any event, I probably am digressing too much. Let's get out of the subtractive to the additive part. Quick poll, we are in California. Does the name Clark Kerr still have any resonance out here? Yeah, we're getting applause for Clark. He ran UCal Berkeley up the road here back in the 60s, which must have been a really entertaining job. He was still in charge when they tear gassed the Regents. All the old timers in here are nodding and smiling. Yeah, California used to be a cool place. They tear gassed the Regents every once in a while, just to, you know, give them that commonality with the people sort of touch. You all get tear gassed together. Well, Clark wrote a book. He wrote several, actually, but he wrote this one particular book, came out, I think, 1963, sometime in the early 1960s. Very interesting little piece of work. Now, 1963 is a long time ago. You'd think this is a little bit outdated. Harvard University just republished it. This is not coincidental. The book in question is titled Use of the University, and it lays out this vision of how these institutions are supposed to work. And this fits into the New World Order, the militarism, the corporatism, and all the rest of everything we've been talking about all night. Here's their vision for you. The other side of the subtractive part. Kerr set up the schematic vision of the university as follows. You got raw material, students. You've got a workforce, the workers. That's the faculty. You've got funders. Well, hey, they're the same guys that own the actual factories, okay? These would be the corporations and some selected areas of government, but primarily corporate. And then you got this managerial class, which are the university administrations, and they're responsible to the funding entities to ensure that the workers do a proper job in molding the raw material into a finished product of use to the funders, the corporations. Okay, basically the idea is to turn these higher educational institutions into glorified vote-techs. That's it. You're to get critically, well, they're fairly advanced, they're fairly complicated, okay? You got some technical stuff here that's hard to learn, but they need a workforce that's basically well-trained in these areas. That's what you're to be trained in, okay? No clutter of contentiousness about analyzing what these skills are to be used for. You're simply to get the skills imparted in a block section of ideological support for doing whatever it is they want you to do with it in an efficient manner once you're out. No side chatter. That's the vision. Gee, I wonder why Harvard just came out with it in the midst of the kickoff campaign on a national purge of dissident voices in the academy. One side completes the other. Now, is this conjectural? This institution is accredited. It doesn't function. Your degree is useless without that degree being from an accredited institution. There are accrediting agencies that ensure that certain standards and forms are complied with. That's the basis for the accreditation. Nobody ever stops to wonder who accredits the accrediting agencies, however. They're treated as if they were some sort of an autonomous entity floating around out there that the institutions are accountable to, and that ensures the integrity of the education received by the students who pass through them, and the marketability of degrees. Well, actually, the accrediting agencies report to the Department of Education of the federal government of the United States. The accrediting agencies are accredited, in other words, by whoever is installed as a Secretary of Education and his or her delegates. Well, the delegates have been telling the accrediting agencies right here in California very recently, hey, we need help, the accrediting agencies are saying, because they're telling us that we need to incorporate a whole new component into the criteria of accreditation. That is employer satisfaction. Are the corporations happy with the products coming out of the institutions? And they've even got a concrete recommendation as to the model for assessment of how the institutions are functioning. It's called the University of Phoenix. You know, it's a mail order house funded for corporate execs in mid-career to get their credentials in the particular skills areas that will take them to the next step up the ladder. That's to be applied to all institutions of higher education. The accrediting agencies don't want to do it. And what they're being told by the feds, we'll pull your ticket and we'll do the accrediting ourselves. I'm not making it up or being rhetorical about glorified vo-tech. Now, I don't think that's why you signed in to a university in the first place, but I'm also pretty sure most of the faculty members here, all of whom could probably be employed by University of Phoenix or a comparable institution if you desired to, really wanted to work in that particular environment as the workforce shaping the product for the edification of corporate employers on the backside of the bachelor's degree being conveyed to your students. But you better take this seriously, because they're not talking about it, they're doing it. They're moving on it. It's happening as I speak. And academia, of course, is the citadel for critical engagement with orthodoxy. It is the one remaining area. Federal judiciary and tenured faculty members are the two areas where people have licensure free, in theory at least, from political intervention to state what's on their mind and follow their beliefs. Well, I'm standing here symbolizing they're trying to knock a hole in the other, and they're actually using me as a wedge to get at the whole institution of tenure, and AAUP is beginning to equivocate on it, and you've got faculty people out there saying, well, maybe it'd be to our advantage to be in the open market. It would take our salaries up to executive levels, perhaps, if we were actually doing what it was that was valued by society. Who the hell is society? The guys in the corporate boardrooms become the synonym for society. You will be working for them. And they will pay you well to do it. I'm sure they always do, because they've got all the resources in the society already. Having taken them away from you, they will then give you little dribbles back to do what you're told and call yourself free and convince your students that they're free too. Well, that's the one side, and you might notice that that other ethical giant of the Republican Party that is holding a key position in Congress at present, unlike Newt, who got banished, thankfully, but now he's a talking head on TV. Funny how these guys get convicted of crimes and end up being like Ollie North or Poindexter back in government. All right? You got all of that, so it really doesn't have anything to do with adherence to the stated rules and norms of society. It has to do with your particular utility and willingness to basically disregard the rules and norms in the interests of power. Well, Tom DeLay, that's the ethical giant I'm talking about now, has gone up to the judiciary hammer and tong as well, hasn't he? So the two remaining areas where you got theoretical safeguards against these guys just rolling over you and being able to penalize you for the exercise of inconvenient speech are both under serious attack from these defenders of freedom that inhabit the corridors of power in Washington right now. On the scale of things that I've been talking about, massive violation of the laws of war, abridgment of the Constitution, wholesale violation of treaties, and commission of the crime of genocide, this does not seem like a significant issue. What happens to the judiciary, since the laws are relevant to those in power anyway, by and large, and what happens to the tenure of overprivileged faculty members But these are the last two barriers. There's no ground to give. If you give them up, the game is lost. So you have to take it seriously as the wedge to get back at the consciousness of people. Because without the consciousness of the nature of the opponent, you cannot possibly confront the opponent in such a way as to transform your situation from a negative into a positive. Nature of struggle is contingent on consciousness, and we are in the consciousness business in the academy, and it's time we took our job seriously for the first time in decades. If it is just a job and you're collecting a check, go get yourself a job that pays better. If it's a vocation, start being about it. Stop equivocating. Stop trying to protect the institution. Stop trying to protect the institution by equivocating the whole purpose of the institution. You can't play it safe and survive in this environment. You got to stand out there and say what's on your mind and not back up. That's the message of my case, and that's my message of the evening, and I thank you for listening. Matakiasi.